Give me a thumbs up and I'll know. Good morning and welcome to Buxton United Methodist Church. We are so glad that you came to worship with us today. And to all of the ladies in our midst, I want to say Happy Mother's Day or Happy Mothering Day, whichever you prefer. Let's take a look at our morning announcements. Do we have any celebrations here today? Birthdays or anniversaries? Yes.
My niece Jessie is in Idaho, but yep. She just had a birthday and she just had twins.
Wow, that's another joy. Baby's being born. Super, your niece, that's wonderful. Thank you. Any others? Yes, Lynn.
It's not past the Lynn's birthday is Tuesday.
Oh,
Tuesday.
Yes.
I was going to let that go.
And she's double numbers.
Yes, I'm double numbers. Yeah. Yes.
I had a meeting last night with a longtime friend showed up who had been battling cancer. Mm-hmm. And he is right now on the road to recover. So it's a celebration that
that is wonderful.
Able to go to the meeting.
Oh, and praise God. We'll lift that up in joys, right? Make sure to lift his name up when we get to prayer time. That's good. Okay. All right, so let's go before the Lord our God in, let's keep going in the announcements. You know what, Kevin, I went way too fast. I'm sorry, I kind of got ahead of myself. It's a new month. Remember those who are homebound and living in care facilities, if you need that list again, let me know. It'd be great to go ahead and do some cards. One or two a month, if you do just one or two a month and go through that list. It's really going to make a difference, okay? Keep up with your Bible reading challenge. We have three different kinds going, so that's good. Easter season Bible study continues Wednesday, 9 a.m. All are welcome. We are currently studying 1 Peter, and we'll be going to the Vatican, and we'll be visiting the Sistine Chapel this week, so that's going to be pretty exciting for our trip. Anything else?
Should we say happy birthday?
Oh, no. I think we should skip. That's why I tried. Did you see how I did that?
Thank you.
Mother's Day story. Yesterday was our great grandchild Allie's 8th birthday, and she had there was a party given for her at the old Baldwin School, and 8 of her little girlfriends came, and their moms, and little ones. So we saw even a little baby that was, well, she was 8 months old at that point. And then there was a mother there, for her soon-to-be mother, who her husband, our grandson, owned a plumbing business together. And 2 years ago, she had a stillborn baby boy, and they haven't been able to have any more. Well, we've been praying, as I've told Linda, and she brought in a little picture of a sonogram on her phone, and she's 10 weeks long. So we were all real happy about that. And then I left there and went to see my sister and her husband at Felmouth by the Sea. They both have Parkinson's. And there's a wonderful nurse there named Maggie. She's just great. She's got a good heart. And she said, come with me. And she brought me into the Alzheimer's ward. And there were 5 women sitting around, and they were all holding what they call their doll babies. And they were listening to Frank Sinatra. And it was really good. And one of them had had a doll baby, and her son brought in the other 4 women to have doll babies for this weekend. So they all had their little blankets, and they were looking at their babies. And I was thinking, we're starting from the beginning, birthdays, and then with Alzheimer's. Mm-hmm. All of them were mothers, one way or another, and it was really good. And like they say, the mother rocks the cradle that rocks the world. So I was really pleased. Mothers are where it's at. And you don't have to really be a mother to be a mother. You just have to care. And that was it. So maybe you stand and we'll start with a call to worship. And this is from Proverbs 31. A woman of noble character is worth 5 more than rubies.
She opens her arms to the poor and extends her hands to the needy.
She is clothed with strength and dignity. She can laugh at the days to come.
She speaks with wisdom, and faithful instruction is on her tongue.
She watches over her household and does not eat the bread of idleness.
Her children rise and call her blessed. Her husband also sings her praises.
Charm is deceptive and beauty is fleeting, but a woman who lives in reverent awe of God is to be praised.
Give her the reward she has earned, and let all who she blesses get her.
And please join in the opening prayer, which was written by Daniel Darling. Lord,
give all women a worshipful reverence of you, the creator and sustainer of all life. Help each mother to rest in the knowledge that they are but stewards of your children, and that only your spirit can produce change in the hearts of each boy and girl. May each mother find rest in you. Most of all, Lord, on this day in which we honor mothers, may we love and cherish the special women who have borne us, who have nurtured us, and who have prayed for our well-being. May our hearts overflow with gratitude to you, who formed and knitted each of us together in a mother's womb.
Amen. And please stay standing and sing praise to the Lord, the Almighty, United Methodist Hymn 139, or up here on the screen on the wall.
Glory, 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 glory,
The Old Testament scripture this morning is Proverbs 1, 7 through 9. Knowledge begins with respect for the Lord, but foolish people hate wisdom and self-control. My child, listen to your father's teaching and do not forget your mother's advice. Their teaching will beautify your life. It will be like flowers in your hair or a chain around your neck. The epistle this morning is 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 3 through 4. It is not fancy hair, gold jewelry, or fine clothes that should make you beautiful. No, your beauty should come from within. You, the beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit. This beauty will never disappear and is worth very much to our Lord. And now we're going to be blessed with the choir singing Faith of Our Mothers. It'll sound familiar. I'm later a while, though the brook dried up because there was no rain, then the Lord spoke his word to Elijah. You must now go to Zarephath in Sidon. Live there. I have commanded a widow there to take care of you. So Elijah went to Zarephath. When he reached the town gate, he saw a widow there. She was gathering wood for a fire, and Elijah asked her, would you bring me just a little cup of water to drink? I would like to have it to soothe my throat. As she was going to get his water, Elijah said, oh yes, please bring me a piece of bread with it also. The woman answered, as surely as the Lord your God lives, I tell you the truth today, I have no bread. I have only a little oil left in a jug. I came here to gather some wood. I am going to take it home and cook our last meal. My son and I will eat it and then we'll die from hunger. Elijah said to her, don't worry, go home and cook your food as you have said, but first make me a small loaf and of the bread from the flour that you have, and bring it to me, then cook something for yourself and your son. The Lord, the God of Israel, says, that jar of flour will never become empty, and the other jug will always have oil in it. This will continue until the day that the Lord will send rain to the land once more. So the woman went home, and she did what Elijah told her to do. So Elijah, the woman, and her son had enough food every day. The jar of flour and the jug of oil never, ever went empty. This happened just as the Lord, through Elijah, said it would. And all who believe in the scripture, please say amen.
Amen.
And now we're going to be singing A Mother Lined a Basket. It's in the Faithfully Sing. It's up here on the wall, 2189. And happy Mother's Day to you all.
Thank you.
Now may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable unto your sight, O God, our strength and our Redeemer. Well, we are still in the Easter season, but I am taking the opportunity today to have our message be in alignment with Mother's Day. So I hope you're okay with that. I guess if not, you'll have to come up and preach. I noticed we didn't have any volunteers, so it's Mother's Day it is. You might be thinking to yourselves that your pastor has really lost it. That would not be a surprise. She's gone off the deep end, for sure. With Mother's Day, many women of the Bible come to mind, such as those we just sang of. Jochebed. She saved baby Moses by making the basket and floating him down the river to safety. Or Hannah, who prayed and prayed for a child and finally received Samuel. Mary, the mother of Jesus, comes to mind from the New Testament, or even Dorcas from the book of Acts. But Elijah and the widow of Zarephath? Pastor Lynn's lost her marbles for sure. But just stick with me. Trust me, and you'll see. Our passage begins with Elijah telling King Ahab that God's message to him was that there would be neither dew nor rain except at his, Elijah's, word. And there had been none for 3.5 years. This is all going to lead, of course, to a big showdown on Mount Carmel. But in this desert climate, there's been neither rain nor dew for 3.5 years. They don't have artesian wells. Now, when we think of desert climates, being from America, probably the desert Southwest comes to mind. We don't have much of a rainy season, but even in the desert Southwest, there's usually a bit of rain in the summertime with some tremendous thunderstorms. In Israel, however, there are two very regular seasons. You can almost set your watch to it. That's how regular the two seasons are. October through April is when they have winter and it rains. October through April is cool and wet. Whereas May through September is hot and dry with little rain. But there's a natural cycle of this. Back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. So to go 3.5 years without rain or even any dew, that's a downright miracle, and not a good one at that. We wouldn't want to be the recipient of that miracle. It's not like the multiplication of loaves and fish, right? That one would be a good one to receive. No rain or dew when you live in a desert. Not a miracle I would want to experience. This was bad news for King Ahab. And even worse for the people of the land, right? Because the king always gets the best. The people get what's left over, the subjects. At this point in time, you can bet there was much suffering happening due to King Ahab's stone cold, unyielding heart. This is what it was about. Elijah has now gone to Zarephath, and he encounters this unnamed widow. Bold Elijah asks this widow for water when it hasn't had rain or dew for 3.5 years. Okay? Bold Elijah. Water is scarce. Let's try to get a picture in our mind Zarephath. Now, that's a place between ancient Tyre and Sidon on the Mediterranean coast. It's modern-day Sarafan in Lebanon, about 50 miles north of the Israeli border, or about halfway between the northern Israel border on the coast of the Mediterranean Sea and the city of Beirut in Lebanon, just to give you a picture. So what? What does all that mean? Anne says, I still can't picture it. Mediterranean north of Israel. It means that this woman was a Canaanite. That makes her a Gentile. She's not Jewish. And Elijah is a prophet of the Jewish people. And furthermore, Zarephath just happened to be the capital of Baal worship. This is going to be the showdown between Elijah and the one true God of Israel and the people practicing Baal worship and their child sacrifice. So think back to your Sunday school lessons. God told Elijah to pray for there to be no rain to try to turn King Ahab's cold stone heart back to God. Because Ahab was off worshiping Baal and committing child sacrifices with his wife Jezebel, who happened to be the queen of Baal worship. So everyone knew who Elijah was. In the minds of most people, Elijah was the one that had brought the trouble of drought upon them all. And that's when this encounter happens. There's been no rain or dew for 3.5 years. In the desert. This very poor Gentile woman, she's poor because she's a widow trying to raise a child. She knows who Elijah is right away. I suspect not too many people walked around wearing camel's hair and a leather belt for fashion. He was probably an easy guy to figure out. This Gentile woman was not angered, though, by his presence. In fact, she's well disposed toward him. God had made her that way, we are told. And I think it's safe to say that she recognizes that the God of Elijah is greater than the storm god, Baal, the storm god. No surprise there, right? He's the one that's supposed to bring the rain. But she had. So when this prophet of the one true God asks her for something, she does it, even though it's scarce. She gets him water to drink when there's hardly a drop to be found anywhere. But Elijah then pushes her a little more. Pushes her, in fact, to the breaking point when he asks her for bread to eat as well. That's the straw that broke the camel's back. I love this woman because she's not afraid to speak her mind. She's confident. She doesn't hold anything in, biting her tongue. Verse 12 tells us, she looks at this great prophet and says, as surely as the Lord your God lives, I don't have any bread. Only a handful of flour in a jar and a little olive oil in a jug. I'm gathering these few sticks to take home and make our last meal for my son and I to eat before we die. Right now, she is desperate for help. Their last meal. She's destitute. No rain means that the wheat and the barley crops have been non-existent. No wheat or barley for 3.5 years means no flour. No flour means no bread. She's desperate. And in her desperate situation, she does what we humans tend to do. This widow focused on the little she had instead of what God will provide. God, whom we've that she knows of and sees as mightier than the God she was raised with. Now, I want to say the first part of that again because I think it's so true to human nature. In a desperate situation, she focused on the little she had instead of what God is able to provide. How many of us here today have ever been in that place? I know I have. It's human nature to focus on what we have right in front of us rather than put our focus on what God is able to do and provide for us, especially when we feel desperate. We mortals, we zone right in on what little we have instead of having the faith we need in Jehovah Jireh. God is my provider. We do this, I think, because in times when the cupboards get bare and the bank account gets low, the problems begin to pile up into a giant heap, and we wonder how on earth we'll ever dig ourselves out of this hole. It's in those times that we experience fear. We're afraid. How are we going to make it? Elijah knows this. That's why the first thing he says to her in the next verse is, "Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid." I think in that sentence he's saying to her also, without these exact words, "Believe in God, and God will provide for you." Elijah continues. He says, "Go home. Do just as you said. Make that loaf of bread for you and your son, but first, make a loaf of bread and bring it to me. Then, go back and make something for yourself and your son." This is a test, right? And this gal passes with flying colors. She does just what he said to do. That reminds me of the story of the person who's walking for days and is desperate for water. They come to an abandoned farmhouse where there's an old well pump with a small bottle of water beneath it and a note on the bottle. The note says, "Use this water to prime the pump, but you need to use every drop." What would you do in that situation? Do you take the chance and use the only water there to hope that the pump is primed and will give you more water? Or do you drink that bottle of water? That's a sure thing, right? This woman is a similar situation, and it's bleak. She has enough flour and oil to make only one small cake of bread, most likely a little round pancake-sized pita. It's the only one she has. Does she share it with her son or give it away to the guy who everybody knows is refusing to pray for rain and put an end to all their suffering? This woman has tremendous faith. She gives it away. She serves Elijah before herself. Now, isn't that such a mom thing to do? Moms are always serving everybody else before themselves. Most mothers go about 20 years before they ever get to sit down and have a hot meal because they're always up on their feet serving everybody else. I see some people shaking their heads. Yeah, that's about right. That's this sweet woman of faith. She serves Elijah. And in this, we learn two very important things from the example of this wonderful, unnamed lady in the scriptures. The first thing we learn is that she had a servant's heart. Even in a desperate situation, she followed God's leading by serving Elijah first before her own family. Or to put it another way, she put God's wishes first in her life, didn't she? That's the first lesson from her example. We're all to have servant hearts, always, no matter what situation we're in times of plenty and in times of want, where they have servant hearts. Second, this woman had faith. She gave away the last of the food that she had. Once she made that little cake of bread, there was nothing left, my friends. But God wanted her to make it and give it away first before the provision would come. She had to have faith in God in order to do that. Her faith was rewarded by the flour and the oil never running out. Despite the fact the drought that had led to famine in the land had not stopped. No rain, no crops, no crops, and a widow couldn't glean the fields. But she did have faith. And she came to trust in the one true God who is sufficient to meet every one of her needs. I can't help but wonder on this Mother's Day, do we believe that today? Do we believe that God is sufficient to meet all of our needs? Yes, we do. Now, that doesn't mean it's always easy. Sometimes it's downright difficult, in fact. But in the hard times, when it is difficult to trust in God's sufficiency to meet all of your needs, I hope every one of us here today will remember the story of this Gentile woman. She gave away her only cake of life-giving bread, but in return, she received the nourishment she needed for life. A spiritual bread to nourish her soul. She gained a faith in God, and her life was changed for the better from that day forward. And that doesn't mean she didn't have hard times, because she did. But she gained a faith, and she knew that she could trust God to meet her every need. Friends, God was sufficient for this unnamed widow. God was sufficient, I would say, for our mothers, which is why we are all sitting here in this church right now. Amen? May God always be sufficient for each every one of our needs, too. That is a lesson we will then pass on to our children and our grandchildren and our great-grandchildren by our example. And all God's people say, amen. It's time to go before the Lord our God in prayer. Would you please remember to lift up the first names only of those we lift up? Let us pray. Oh Lord God, we thank you so much for the story of this unnamed widow who put her trust in you, and despite life continuing to hand her difficult times, she remained faithful. She gained faith in you and trust in you. And she realized that you were sufficient for all her needs. Help us, Lord God, to follow that example, even in the times that are difficult. Lord God, we come before you today and we think about the many things that have been wonderful that have happened this week. Oh, Lord God, we thank you for the sunshine. It has felt so good, and we just are so thankful. And we lift up now before you any of the joys that we have.
Jerry.
Alex.
For all of the mothers and women who have mothered us in our lives. For these things, Lord God, that have been spoken, and for those that remain unspoken, but in our hearts and in our minds, we give you thanks and say, Lord, hear our praise. And we come before you now, Lord God, and we lift up those things that weigh heavy on our hearts, things within our church. families and friends, nation, world. We begin with our church family needs, and we pray for Sandy's mother, Norma, who is suffering right now and very sick. We pray for Patty, Wendy, and Betsy, for Clint, Janice, and Sean, all who are sick or hurting. And Lord, we lift up Mary and pray that you would continue to be with her and strengthen her and help her with her balance. And now, Lord, we lift up the others that we have from within us, that from within the life of our congregation and our cities and our nations and world. Thank you.
Steve and Steve.
Sharon. And Lord, we remember that there is still a war raging in Ukraine, and we pray, Lord God, that there would be an end to that, as well as, Lord, a ceasefire in Israel and the Gaza Strip. We pray for the conflict between the Palestinians and the Israelis to come to an end, Lord God, and for there to be peace. For all these things we say, Lord, hear our prayer. And we pray now the prayer that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I want to thank our Renee, who has picked up these beautiful roses in honor of all the ladies in our congregation and in our lives. And in our final hymn, our Callie, I believe, is going to be passing them out to any of our ladies. So thank you for that. Would you please stand if you're able? Our final hymn is to a familiar tune. It's to Sweet Hour of Prayer, and it's called O Mother's Love.
Thank you.
Christian lives. May the Lord who provides for all our needs sustain us every day. And the Lord whose steadfast love is constant as a mother's care, send us out to be an example.